Praise the Lord. Last week we started a little series on 1 Corinthians 13, which is also known as the love chapter. And we really just got through the first few verses, and essentially mostly what we talked about in reference to that first message had to do with the fact that gifts are good, but God is love. Amen. And one of the things that we learned, we talked a little bit about the church of Corinth itself and kind of somewhat of the atmosphere, where it was located, the different things that were going on in its society, the carnality. And, you know, we don't need to rehash all of that. But one of the things about the church was the fact that the church was abounding in gifts. You know, and a lot of times in the modern church, especially in gift-driven churches, like whether they be Pentecostal or charismatic in nature, there's always a real big focus on the gifts. Bless you. There's always a real big focus on the gifts of the Spirit, and we love the gifts of the Spirit. But one of the things that we see about the letter to the church of Corinth is that it's a letter that's full of correction, and sometimes we don't realize that. And it doesn't seem as though it's pretty evident that the church in Corinth was elevating the gifts. And I even read a passage of out of a book last week about the Azusa Street Revival and how the same thing happened during the Azusa Street Revival, that people started elevating the Holy Ghost and the gifts. And the ministry of the Holy Spirit is always to point the people back to Jesus. That's what he always does. That's his purpose. Jesus even said that the Spirit of truth, and he spoke about what the Holy Spirit would not take of his own, but would take of what was Jesus's, and would reveal that to the disciples, and would continue to reveal the work of Christ as time went forward. And so that was one of the things that we talked about. But we also talked about, I mentioned to you that there's several different words that describe the word love in the Greek language. I mentioned three of them, but we really talked about two. But the emphasis, we talked about phileo love, which is brotherly love, but then the emphasis of the message had to do with agape, if you'll remember that. And that the word agape, I'm on the wrong thing here. Just a second. I didn't. The word agape has to do with, actually the definition says that it recognizes the worth of the object being loved. And so, and the worth of the value of the object being loved in reference to what God is doing has to do with your eternal soul, and the value that God placed on your eternal soul was the life of Jesus. Amen. The one who never did anything wrong, the eternal Son, the eternal Word that spoke the worlds into existence. God's beautiful plan allowed Jesus. See, this is a definition straight out of Kenneth Wee's Greek dictionary. This is how the word agape was utilized in the Greek language. And it takes on whole new meaning whenever the New Testament's written and understands the worth of the object being loved. What does that mean? Well, I tried to explain it to you last week. Phileo love is different. I may love you. I may love you. And a lot of times my love is built upon things that I like about you. Fact of the matter is that there's certain things that I like about the people I love. You know, whether it's your personality I like or whatever it is, God's not about that. God sees past that. God's not caught up in the way that you look, in the way that you talk, in the car you drive, in how much money you have in your bank account. God is all about loving you because you're worth something to Him, because you're an eternal soul, and you're either going to spend eternity with Him in communion and fellowship, or you're going to spend eternity separated from His presence. The worth and the value of you and related to agape has to do with Jesus and the giving of His life to purchase you so that you can have a relationship with Him. Amen? That's agape. And listen, it's a long road to travel to get that concept of agape from what God looks like into my heart anyway. I'm just going to be perfectly honest with you. But I will tell you this, good news, that when agape shows up, you'll know it. And the reason that you'll know it is because it is something that is so foreign to everything that you ever knew before, you will know that it's not something that you just produced on your own. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? It's a love of another kind. It's when the love of God becomes resident on the inside of your heart. Essentially, it's the fruit of the Spirit. And one of the things that I've talked about a lot of times, the reason that they call it the fruit of the Spirit is because it's not the fruit of you. You understand? It has to be produced through the person of the Holy Spirit in you, and the change is taking place so deep. See, that's what the grace of God does. The grace of God reaches on the inside of a human heart, and it begins to change things internally to the point that things begin to change externally. Fruit is something you can see, touch, hold. You can behold it. You understand? And so when the fruit of the Spirit is moving and operating in a person's life, it becomes evident externally. Now, one of the things that I would like to bring up, and I know that we talk about this a lot, but I don't want us to get lost in all of this. You know, we talk about the certain aspect of the gospel a lot. One of the things that we talk about is that mankind born of Adam is born dead in sin. Right? I mean, that's the story. And the reason that we have to go back to this is because as we start talking, today we're going to talk about some things that you would probably call practical Christianity. Now, maybe my definition of practical Christianity would differ than some people in the area, maybe the way that we would teach it, but that's neither here nor there. But practical Christianity is where your Christian life affects the lives of others. And some of the things that we're going to talk about, sometimes that can have to do with giving. There's actually a portion of scriptures that's going to talk about that, the heart of giving. But what you got to understand is we don't want to get so caught up in practical Christianity that we forget the change that has to take place inside of the heart and the spiritual change that actually causes the motivation behind it. Because you can do good stuff for people all day long, but you can still be doing it from the motives of a selfish heart, from the motives of wanting to be seen by men. Come on. Somebody said that the Pharisees pay tithes of mint and cumin, but and they strain a gnat out of a cup. What does that mean? See, a gnat would have been something unclean that fell into their cup, and so therefore they strain, they get a little strainer out to get the gnat out, but then he says, then you devour a camel. And a camel was an unclean beast. And the point that Jesus was trying to make is that you're paying tithes on your mint and your cumin, these little bitty seasonings and spices, and you want everybody to see it. Oh, look, here he did. He took a walk all the way down there, and he came and stuck his little tithe of his mint and his cumin in the tithe box. But the reality of it is that you're just full of religious pride. And all you just want to be seen by men. You just want to be elevated. You want everybody to see how holy you are, how self-righteous you are. The motives of your heart are wrong. You can do all kinds of stuff for people in the community, and ain't no Jesus really living on the inside of your heart, and you think you're so much better than everybody else. And the reality of it is that you got hardness in your heart. You look down on somebody because they got problems with drugs and alcohol. You look down on somebody because they got this going on in their life. Oh, Lord, help you. Because Jesus doesn't look like that. Yes. Jesus doesn't act like that. Jesus loves and he lays down his life and he gives his life so that others might live and have wholeness to their heart. Amen. That's what Jesus looks like. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. It's a love that comes from another realm. I'm here to tell you right now, it comes from another realm. And so before you can get into practical Christianity, you got to know how this stuff is produced. And man born of Adam is born in sin, but hallelujah, good news, God has a plan. Amen? And the plan is that it requires faith. Faith in Jesus Christ and what he did for you at the cross. Now what that does is it allows God to see you put in Jesus. Amen. The old man born of Adam, born in sin. That's why you got to be born again. Nobody ever told you that before. I know we've talked about it. But that's why you got to be born again. Because the first time you were born, can I say it? Jacked up. Is it all right just to talk real every now and then? You were born messed up, man. Amen. I don't care if you got to pay your bills all the time. You were born messed up. And you got a sin nature on the inside of you. And if you don't learn how to let the Holy Ghost deal with that through the finished work of Jesus on the cross, you might think you're okay, but you're far from it. Let me just tell you. Because see, God doesn't do rehab. That's another problem we got in the church today. They got all these Christian rehabs. I'm not saying that you can't get somebody away from their environment. And if you teach them the true gospel, that you can't allow the Holy Ghost to do a work. But listen to me. God doesn't do rehab. If they're not teaching you over there that the old man born of Adam must die, and he must be buried, and a new man must be resurrected in newness of life, then you're not teaching them the gospel.
Amen. That's right.
And whenever you place your faith in Christ and what he did for you at the cross, in the mind of God, the old man dies. Amen?
Amen.
He's buried. Rest in peace, Adam. And a new man is resurrected to newness of life. Amen? Amen. And he's in a new position. He's in Christ. So now the understanding of righteousness is that it's because I'm in Jesus. It's because of my faith in Jesus. It's because Jesus, the righteous one, died on the cross and he paid the penalty for my sin. And now through faith in the mind of God, the old man that was born of Adam was put in Jesus. And in God's mind, I died with Jesus. And in God's mind, the old man was buried with Jesus. And in God's mind, the new man was resurrected in Jesus. And now if I'll just believe what God believes, I can walk in Jesus. Amen. And the righteousness of God will fill me up. And the Holy Spirit will move in me and begin to do things on the inside of me, changing me. I got to tell you this first before we get into practical Christianity. Because I can tell you what you're supposed to act like all day long. And the reality of it is that if we don't understand how or where to keep our faith on a daily basis, trusting the Lord and recognizing, it's important to recognize when you're missing the mark. Amen?
Amen.
It's important to recognize when you're missing the mark and you don't act right. And then you can bring it to the Lord. You say, Lord, I need you to move and operate in the midst of this circumstance in my life. I need you to do something in me. Amen? Amen. And so we're going to go ahead and read 1 Corinthians chapter 13 again real quick. It says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity. And once again, that word could, we use the King James Version of the Bible here. But in some translations, it may say love. And the word there in the Greek is agape. All right. If I have not agape, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. Though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not agape, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I have my body to be burned and have not agape, it profits me nothing. You realize too, before I forget this, that God is agape. But this letter is being written to the church. And so what the Apostle Paul, or what the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul is exhorting the church at Corinth is this. You're supposed to have some agape in you. You're supposed to have the love of God in you.
Amen?
Amen? And so we're talking about how we interact with other human beings. Especially the body of Christ. But also humanity in general. Amen? And so I just need you to understand that that's what this letter is being written for, at least in this specific chapter. It's human-to-human relationship. But till you get that right, it's going to be difficult to interact properly with another human being. All right? I just want to make sure you understand that. Verse 4 is kind of where we start our text today. Agape suffers long and is kind. Agape envies not. Agape vaunteth not itself. It is not puffed up. It does not behave itself unseemly. It seeks not her own and is not easily provoked. It thinks no evil. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Agape never fails, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three. But the greatest of these is charity. So last week, once again, we spoke about the fact that gifts are good, but God is love. And we talked about how Corinth had gifts, but they didn't seem to have love. And in these next few verses, we're going to see adjectives and concepts that are utilized to describe what agape looks like. And one of the things that you'll begin to realize is, or at least I began to realize as I was studying and writing, was that first off, they're so reminiscent of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. But not only that, if you really think about it, you will begin to see a picture, a projection of the life of Christ as though it's being displayed upon a screen as we begin to read a little bit more closely some of the concepts that are behind these adjectives that describe agape and what it's supposed to look like in the human life. And so once again, I want you to know this, though, and I know I was talking about this already, but agape is from a foreign, it's foreign to our realm. It's foreign to our understanding. The greatest kind of love that you feel like you could have towards someone, I'm telling you right now, I don't care how pure you think it is, how precious you think it is, there will still be elements of selfishness and improper motives on the inside because the human heart is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? Amen? And part of the problem is that because we come from this fallen realm. We come from this fallen earth. And I love this passage of scripture right here in 1 John 3:1. It says, "Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us." Yeah. I've told y'all this story before, you may not remember, but after the Lord got a hold of me, and I was waking up early in the morning, about 4:30 in the morning, and I'm just telling you, the love of God had overwhelmed my life. I had been in so much pain for so long, I'd been playing the game of Christianity for so long, I'll never be the same. I'm far from perfect, brothers and sisters, but let me tell you, I will never be the same. The love of God overwhelmed me. You hear me?
Amen.
There ain't nowhere else for this boy to go. And I can remember waking up that morning, and I must have read this scripture, and I just said, "What manner of love is this that you bestowed upon me, Lord?" I can remember the day that foreign love came from another realm and dropped down on the inside of my heart and began to change things on the inside of me. And the interesting thing is that word manner right there is literally what it means. From what country, nation, or tribe? Where did this come from? That's what the author's trying to say. This is foreign to our thinking. It's foreign to our way of life. It's foreign to who we are. God done showed up and put himself in us. And whenever he really shows up, I'm telling you, you're going to know when you start to feel the love of God because it goes against everything
yes.
that you would want to do.
Amen.
So right here, we're at this verse, charity or agape suffers long and is kind, and agape envies not, it vaunts not itself, it's not puffed up. Suffers long is the first thing that I want to talk to you about. And I talk about this concept a lot because it's one of my favorite passages of scripture when it talks about the fruit of the spirit and the lust of the flesh. Long suffering. Suffers long. That's what the word means right there. Macrothymia, macro meaning big or long. Thymia, it comes from the word thumos, which has to do with passion or suffering. But the idea is that you suffer long. And literally the idea is the capacity to be wronged and not to retaliate. I see people's faces already getting twisted up. The capacity to be wronged yet not retaliate.
I need that.
Hey, hallelujah. We all need it, brother. Let me tell you, because if you leave Matt to himself, he doesn't want that capacity. He don't even want that stuff. You hear me? He wants vengeance because Matt doesn't want to be wronged. And Matt wants to take you to court. And Matt wants to confront you. And Matt wants to... Well, I was telling some nursing students the other day at the office. I'm like, you know what? It's just an opportunity for me to tell them I love Jesus. The Lord's changing me. I used to, and still, even though I thought I had the love of God, I still wanted to just confront every situation. Lord, still change me today. I still see it in me. I just can't shut up half the time. It's like, just shut up, dude. Stop.
I know it's me.
Stop it. The capacity to be wronged and not to retaliate. I ain't got to be right in everything. Amen. You just don't have to be right in everything. Even if you're wrong about your interpretation of the scripture, I may not even have to tell you right then. Might not be the right time. It might be, but it might not be. Lord, help me to figure out when and what. You know, but I was thinking about Jesus. I was thinking about the fact that Judas betrayed him. The disciples left him. There he is standing, and the people have a choice, and they say, "Give us Barabbas. We want Barabbas. We don't want this Jesus." And I started thinking to myself, boy, could you imagine the rejection right there? Have you ever been rejected before? Yeah. Have you ever felt what rejection feels like? Mm-hmm. I felt rejection before. And let me tell you something. Whenever you get rejected or whenever you get hurt And whenever you feel like people are doing something purposely to hurt you, the fact of the matter is that it has an opportunity to cause something opposite of long-suffering to rise up on the inside of you. You want to go into defense mode. You want to go into preservation mode. And you want to go back into get you back mode.
Amen.
You understand what I'm getting at? But that's not what Jesus does. Jesus doesn't look anything like that. He doesn't get into get you back mode. No. Jesus hangs suspended from heaven and earth, bleeding, lashed, his back, the flesh on his back lashed, and he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And it doesn't even matter that the religious leaders mock him, the world wags their head, "Oh, you can't even save yourself. How are you going to save anybody?" And even the thieves on the cross in one of the gospels, when they first hang him up there, they ridiculed him along with everybody else. But hallelujah, Jesus is long-suffering. He's not willing that any should perish. He just hangs there, man. He hangs there doing what the Father called him to do. He suffers. He suffers long and he waits till the time is right. And then you know what? He waited long enough and one of those thieves had a heart change. Right there in the midst of all that. That thief had a heart change right there in the midst of all that. And he got a revelation. All of a sudden his eyes opened. I pray to myself. I'm like, "Lord, please help me. Please help me learn how to be a little bit more long-suffering with people that get on my nerves. That I can maybe bite my tongue just a little bit longer. That I could maybe just try to act a little bit sweeter. Because I just don't know when they may get the thief's revelation that their eyes might be open and they might look over there and realize, ooh, I feel the Holy Spirit on that, man. This is Messiah. Look at the way he's been acting. The religious leaders are ridiculing him. And what did he say? He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And he meant it. And at some point in time, I just believe that if we would learn the long-suffering of Jesus, we may not ever have a clue of the impact that we have, hallelujah, in people's lives. Help us, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. But not only is it long-suffering, but it's also kind. I was just thinking of one passage of scripture popped in my head. It was really a concept out of, it's in a couple of the Gospels, but in Mark chapter 6, verse 31, I'm just going to read some of it to you real quick, just so that you can kind of get an idea of what's going on. Mark 6, verse 31 through 37, I'm going to read it. It says, "And he said unto them," talking about Jesus to his disciples, "Come ye yourselves apart into a desert place." In other words, let's get alone. "And rest a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat." In other words, they didn't have any time for themselves. There was no time to lay back and chill. There was no time to just sit on the recliner and flip through the channels and watch ESPN. Jesus and the disciples were doing ministry, and they were being thronged by the crowds. And they didn't even have time to stop and eat. And they were tired and they were weary. And Jesus knew it because his humanity, he could feel it. You don't think he's walking around here like God and never getting tired. Jesus slept. Jesus slept and he ate. He felt humanity. He was a human being. You realize that, right? This isn't just God just walking around on earth. Yes, he never stopped being God, but he functioned as the last Adam. His purpose by the Father was to become the last Adam to make right what the first Adam made wrong. Jesus is tired and he's weary in his body and he's hungry and he knows his disciples are. Let us get away to the side. Let us get some time to ourselves. But the scripture goes on to say, "They departed to their desert place by ship privately, and the people saw them departing, and many knew him, and ran afoot there out of all the cities, and out went them, and came together unto him. Jesus, when he came out, he saw much people, and was moved with compassion toward them." How are you when you're tired and hungry? I'm just asking. Are you moved with compassion towards the people? Help us, Jesus.
Yes, sir.
He says he was moved with compassion towards them because they were as sheep not having a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. So I don't know if you've ever taught for any period of time, if you've ever preached. I mean, I'm telling you right now, it can start to wear you out. Sometimes I feel like I'm not asking you to shab it, baby, or nothing like that. I'm telling you, I like to work out. I like to run. Sometimes whenever the Lord moves through me and I get passionate and whatever the case, I feel like I've actually worked out afterwards. I'm so famished and hungry. It's more than like if I've been lifting weights and running. Because I feel like not only am I mentally exhausted, spiritually exhausted, physically exhausted, but we're talking about Jesus, man. He's been teaching all day long. He knows he's tired. He goes somewhere else. The crowd comes and he doesn't stop. He just keeps on teaching. Keeps on teaching without eating, without sleeping, without resting, because he's moved with compassion for the people. I'm just trying to feel what he's feeling. I'm trying to make it real. You ever been tired before? You know what I'm talking about, right? Exhausted.
Yeah.
Just don't even feel like thinking. Don't ask me no more questions because I don't feel like thinking.
Amen.
That kind of time. That's how tired Jesus was, but he keeps on teaching because he's moved with compassion on the people. And when the day was now far spent, his disciples came unto him and said, "This is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away that they may go into the country round about and into the villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat." He answered and said unto them, "Give ye them to eat." And they say unto him, "Shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat?" You know what the truth is that the story has to do with the fact that Jesus performs a miracle. Not only does he, when he's tired, teach them and out of compassion of his heart towards them, do the right thing, but he also feeds them. And I wanted to talk to you for a second about giving and benevolence. That's really what this means. Agape is kind. Agape is giving. Agape does do for others. Amen. But at the same time, Jesus' motivation behind doing was he was filled with compassion because they were like lost sheep without a shepherd and they needed to be taught. He had to teach them the ways of the kingdom of God because the Pharisees were the complete opposite of what Jesus was, and they weren't moved with compassion on the people's hearts, and they weren't teaching the people the truth. Instead, they were teaching the people's lies and causing them to venture off and go into a wrong direction. So what I'm just trying to tell you is we need to be giving. We need to be benevolent. Amen. But at the same time, we need to make sure that we're giving people the truth. But in your own personal life, I'm just trying to say, long-suffering maybe even goes along with this, because sometimes when you're tired and you're worn out, you just don't feel like going on. If the Lord puts something on your heart to do something out of kindness for another person, you got to remember the purpose on why you did that. I'm preaching to the preacher right now.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you that right now, because sometimes I get tired. Sometimes I get hungry. And sometimes I get a little bit discouraged. I'm not going to lie to you. Sometimes I get a little bit discouraged. Oh, you ain't supposed to say that, preacher. No, you're going to hear the truth. Sometimes I get tired, I get weary, and I get discouraged. But you know what? The Lord keeps reminding me, well, who are you doing this for, son?
Amen.
You're doing it for them? Because, and when I say them, I'm not pointing to any one of you in particular, right? Let's be careful. Mama called and texted me the other day. "Matthew, I don't like it when you say this because it sounds like you're being rude." And so I did. Okay, Mom, I'm working on it, all right? I'm not talking to any of y'all in specific relation. I'm just trying to say, Lord, you know, I'm over here trying to do what you asked me to do. Who are you doing it for, son? Because if you're doing it for this one or that one, you got the whole thing wrong. Because half the time, nobody's going to appreciate anything you do anyway.
Amen.
I ain't looking for no pity party, man. I'm a big boy. I'll get up and I'll keep on going tomorrow. But sometimes you get discouraged because you expect that people are going to also get a little bit of agape in the inside of their heart. Just a little drop. That's all you're asking for. Hey, open up your heart and let a little bit of agape in there. Amen. Same thing that the people of God see, so that you too can be softened up just a little bit, so that you too can realize we're all part of a community and we're all trying to move forward with the gospel, and we're all supposed to be a body of Christ.
Amen.
So it's okay not just the preacher to have agape, hallelujah, but everybody gets a little bit of agape, and everybody gets a little bit of kindness, and everybody gets a little bit of benevolence, and everybody starts thinking about more than just themselves.
Amen.
That's the way it's supposed to work. Even when you're tired, even when you're worn out, and even when you're discouraged. So if that's you, if you've been helping somebody, and it looks like, you know, sometimes people are just like, "You mean to tell me that's all you're going to give me? I think you're confused. I'm a child of God. You're supposed to give me more than that. You owe me." You ever see people like that? I just thought I was trying to bless you. I went out of my way to try to bless you, and you act like I owe you more. Have you lost your mind? Lord, please give that person some agape. Amen. Wake them up and cause the scales to fall from their eyes so that they can see. Oh, Lord, help us. Jesus, help us. All right, love is kind. Amen. Love doesn't envy. Acts chapter 7, verse 9, it says, the patriarchs were moved with envy, and they sold Joseph into Egypt, but God was with him. I chose that scripture because it's the same exact Greek word that we're talking about in 1 Corinthians 13. The patriarchs, what does that mean? Anybody know? In the context of that story right there, if you had to look at that verse and you said, the patriarchs moved with envy, sold Joseph into Egypt. If you know the story, you should be able to figure that out.
His
brothers, that's right. And they're the patriarchs, right? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob's sons, the 12 tribes, patriarchs, the forefathers of the faith. Amen. The beginnings of Israel. Hallelujah. And so what it's talking about is that Joseph's brothers were moved with envy. See, that was something about Joseph that they knew. Joseph had something that they couldn't have. Joseph had the love of their father in a way that they couldn't have. Now, it's not Joseph's fault that his mom was pretty, Rachel, and that Jacob loved Rachel more than he loved Leah. It wasn't Joseph's fault.
Right.
It's not Joseph's fault that he had the love of his father in a way that they didn't have. And the sad thing is that, you know, Jacob goes and makes him a coat that every time they see that boy, they're reminded he's got something we ain't got. And whenever they saw that he had something that they didn't have and they wanted it, oh, you'd be surprised at the stuff that goes on inside somebody's heart. Half the time, you won't even realize it's there. It's been there so long. You're thinking crazy things, imagining crazy things, and next thing you know, what did the patriarchs do? They take that boy and they throw him into a pit.
Yep.
They kill an animal, they put some blood on it, and they send it back to the daddy saying he was just ravaged by wild animals. Got rid of him. We got rid of that problem. We won't be seeing that little colorful coat anymore. We won't have to worry about that anymore. Envy. Oh, Lord Jesus, help us. Envy will stir up in your heart. You start looking at things in a way that you never even imagined that you would be looking at things. Lord, we need you to do something in there and on the inside of us. I put down here as an example a word in the church. I don't know why, but the Lord just reminded me of this. I can remember one time when I was going to another church, and all of a sudden some preacher got up and he gave a word, and he started an eternity, looked at me. Son, you're supposed to be in ministry, in front of the whole church. Oh, well, that's cool. That's how they give words, in charismatic churches. And he starts calling out all this stuff that, that Matt's supposed to do. And the essence of it had to do with the fact that I was basically supposed to quit my job and go into full-time ministry. And the idea was we're about to shoo you on because you need to get moving. It's time for you to go, is what the idea was. Well, the crazy thing is that many years before that, the Lord put a poem in my heart. And I don't remember exactly how the poem went, but the end of the poem, I wrote it down somewhere, had to do with there was a hill called Calvary, and that is where he bled for me. Because he died, I now can live, and so to him my heart I give. And then it has something to do with, at the end it says, man's voice I cannot hear, 'twas not man's blood which drew me near. And whenever the Lord gave me that word right there, I knew what it meant. It meant men are going to try to tell you what you're supposed to do. Men are going to try to, he said, no. I'm doing something in you that they don't know what I'm doing in you. You listen to me. You listen to my voice, and I'm going to take you where I want you to go, when I want you to go. Amen. And you don't listen to what they tell you. And whenever he said that, it was the craziest thing. People in leadership started coming up and saying, oh, now you got to quit your good little job. And they were like happy about it. They were like laughing and stuff. Oh, you got to quit your good little job because now you got to be a preacher. And afterwards I was praying about that. And what the Lord started showing me? No, you don't quit your job because guess what? I'm the one that talked to you at 1 o'clock in the morning on that Chevron rig whenever I spoke to you and said I had something else for you. And you listened to me and you went to school and you worked hard and you got the degree and I got you the job. And if I want to get rid of the job, then I'll let you know to get rid of the job. But until you hear me tell you to get rid of the job, you don't get rid of the job. And in addition to that, you work harder. You study harder than the boys that are getting paid to study. How about that? And you keep going. going to work. You're not scared of a little hard work, are you, son? No, sir, I'm not scared of a little hard work. Good. Then you study harder than the boys that are getting paid to study. And preach harder than the boys that are getting paid to preach. And hold on to your job. And if I ever tell you to let go of it, then you let go of it. But not a day before. And all I can say is, I thank the Lord that I didn't listen to that man that stood up and gave me that word. And I thank the Lord that I didn't listen. I'm not going to call them clowns. All them people that tried to come up afterwards and tried to say all of them, part all their little words. Oh, no, it was envy is what it was. It was envy. I ain't got the greatest job. I don't make the most money. But I'm telling you right now, they weren't happy about their situation. They did not like the course that their life had taken. And they wanted me to be in the midst of their mess. No, sir, I'm going to do what the Lord's asking me to do, and I'm going to do it according to His time. And listen, there have been people in the midst of this Bible study that thought the same thing before this thing ever got started. Thought the same thing. Oh, you need to do this. You need to do. Hold on a second, Hollis. You've been listening to, you've been crying out to God for me? Have you been crying out to God for me to be able to? No, you haven't. And you know what? The Lord knows how to speak to me. And so what I encourage you to do is hear from God for yourself, amen?
Amen.
And let us not be envious of other people's situations.
Right. Thank you.
And when we see that those things are there, we have to allow the Lord to do a work, amen?
Amen.
On the inside of our heart. So agape doesn't envy. And it doesn't vaunt itself. I put those two together, vaunt itself or puffed up, because they both speak of pride. I was thinking about this one particular situation where Jesus was in John chapter 18. And first off, I was thinking about the fact that whenever he was in the garden and they came to get him, remember that? And Jesus, he perceived that they were there and he knew that they were there for a purpose. And he said, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And in the Greek language, according to what the Greek text says, he said, "Ego eimi." What does that mean? Ego eimi, it means I am. The translators put in there, "I am he." But in reality, what he said was, "I am." And when he said that, and that's a reference back to Moses in the burning bush, right? He's saying, "I am. I am that I am." He's saying, "I am the all-sufficient one." But when he said that, he said, "I am." And he turned. They all fell down under the power of God. He wasn't even trying to prove anything. It's just who he was. It wasn't like he blew on them to knock them down. He just said the truth. "I am." They all fall down under the power of God. But then the next thing you know, he's before Pilate. He's before Pilate, and he's standing there, and Pilate wants to know some answers. He says in verse 33 of chapter 18, Pilate does, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus wants to know, well, who told you that? You know, did somebody, Jesus asked him a question. And then finally, Pilate says, am I a Jew? In verse 35, "Your own nation and the chief priests, they have delivered you unto me. What have you done?" Pilate wants to know what's going on. Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world." See, just as his love comes from another realm, his kingdom comes from another realm. Jesus doesn't handle his business like men on earth do. Men on earth grab swords and cut people's ears off. Men on earth grab swords and thrust them through. Men on earth have generals and armies and they invade countries and they take over. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this earth." And then he said this, "If it was, my disciples would fight." And not only would they fight with their swords, buddy, but let me tell you, you don't want me to say I am right now. Because if I say I am, you're going to fall down. You're going to see what kind of power.
Yes.
See? And that's the kind of power Jesus had.
Amen.
But he holds it because his kingdom is not of this earth. He said that I would not be delivered to the Jews. This is verse 36 at the end. "Now is my kingdom not from here." It's not that it won't ever be my kingdom. Jesus is saying, "I will come back and this earth will be mine. I spoke it into existence. I will redeem it with my blood and I'm going to take it back with a sword in my mouth."
Amen.
It's going to happen, but right now is not the time. Then verse 37, Pilate therefore said unto him, "Are you a king then? Just tell me that part." Okay, no, I'm not, no more playing around. Just tell me, are you a king? And this is what Jesus said. Jesus answered and said, "You say that I'm a king. To this end was I born." Yeah, Pilate, I'm a king. I was born for this purpose. I'm not just a king, but I'm the King of Kings. He didn't tell him that, but that's what Jesus knew. I'm the King of Kings, but Jesus isn't prideful. He isn't vaunting himself. The word vaunt means to be a braggart. Constantly talking about how good you are. Lord, help us not to be that way. Amen. Help me not to be that way. Amen. Constantly talking about how good you are, tooting your own horn, and puffed up. Puffed up and prideful about it. Jesus didn't like that. Jesus answered, this, you say, I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth hears my voice. I was thinking about pride and people that elevate themselves. Thinking about my own life. I know that there's been so many times in my own life that I have been full of pride, and I'm sure that it still oozes out of me today. And it's like, I don't want to be that way. And I was thinking about Jesus here down in chapter 19 too. Verse 2, and the soldiers platted a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe and said, Hail, King of the Jews, and they smote him with their hands. Then came Jesus forth wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said unto them, Behold the man. Can you imagine this picture of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who spoke the worlds into existence, who was just now in a garden and said, I am, and they all fell down under the power of God. And now his back is shredded and lashed, and he has a purple robe and a crown of thorns, and the blood's just streaming down his face. And he just stands there. Isaiah said that he was like a lamb led to slaughter, and he did not open his mouth. He just stands there. He's not puffed up. He's not prideful. He just takes it. And I think about how Jesus was and his demeanor and all that. And he just was not, he didn't have to prove himself. He did not feel as though he had to prove himself to the world. He's going to speak truth, and you're either going to believe it or you're not. Yes, he performed miracles, but even still, the miracles didn't make them all believe. And I was thinking about my own life. And I was thinking, I'm sorry, I keep using myself as an example. I guess I'm just trying to be transparent with you and see that I see myself all messed up in a lot of these things. And sometimes I see where maybe I had it a little bit right for a little while. I was thinking about that old car I used to have. And when I'd bring y'all to school with that blue car. And you told me one time, one of my daughters told me, Daddy, Gabe McKimmy called your car Buku Ratchet. Buku Ratchet. Missing two hubcaps and a dent in the back. And you know, I can remember saying, does that bother you? And they said, no, you know. But you know, one of the things I was thinking is you know what? Oh, well, my kids, they need to know. They need to know that it's not all about the finer things of life. Amen. It doesn't matter whether or not you make, how much money you make. Half the time, people are acting like they make money and they don't even have any money. And they're living so far beyond their means, and they're over there trying to impress everybody. Jesus is just over there with his back lashed, sitting over there with a purple robe, and they're mocking him. And he's the one that spoke the worlds into existence. He's not trying to convince everybody that he is who he says he is. You're either going to believe it or you're not. And you know what? I'm tired. I'm trying to convince everybody of what this is or what that is. The reality of it is that, Lord, help me. Help me to just do what it is that you called me to do. Amen. To move through this life through your grace and not be so consumed and concerned about the clothes I wear, the cars I drive, and this, that, and the other thing, that I get caught up in some kind of a lie of the world system.
Right.
It ain't gonna hurt nobody. I wish I was more like my dad in that sense. I mean, I'm starting to get a little bit better about it, but I can remember telling Dad, dude, why don't you buy another car, man? This car's getting old. Or what about the shoes, man? He bought me a pair of K-Swiss shoes. I don't know if y'all knew what those were. I didn't like them after he bought them. My daddy wore them shoes for 5 years, bro. They were a little too big for him, and the toes started turning up. I'm like, Dad, you got to get rid of them shoes, man. You're killing me. He's like, oh, I want to laugh at me, boy. He said, because why are you laughing? I'm laughing all the way to the bank on the $15 I've been making interest because I've been wearing these shoes for the last however many years. That's how my dad thought. I wish I'd get that part of it right. I'm getting a little bit closer to not that worried about what people think about me. Yeah, I know. You don't believe it, but I think I am. But nevertheless, I wish I'd get the other part right. Lord, $15 interest on 5 years. Boy, he isn't talking about pitching pennies. Anyway, I'm talking about don't vaunt yourself. Don't puff yourself up. Amen. Don't be full of pride. 1 Corinthians 13:5. Agape does not behave itself unseemly. It does not seek her own. It is not provoked easily. It is not easily provoked. And it thinks no evil. And so to be honest with you, to behave unseemly simply means rude. Agape isn't rude. Now, I want you to know that, don't think, because I know people go watch this video, and there's some of them preachers that I used to know still watch these videos. They're like, well, he's preaching to you, preacher. And you're probably right. There's certainly some elements about my personality that are rude. I can admit that. But at the same time, forthrightness and rudeness aren't the same thing. And what I'm trying to get at is this, is that Jesus told the Pharisees, you're a bunch of whitewashed tombs filled with dead men's bones. Your father's the liar. He speaks one language. His language is lies. And you speak the same language he speaks. Now, is that rude or is that forthright? Well, you're not going to tell me Jesus is unseemly.
That's right.
You're not going to tell me Jesus is rude. No, but it's forthright. It's telling the truth.
That's right.
Because they were lying to the people and they were sending them in the wrong direction.
That's right.
It's all about the motives of the heart. And we got to learn to allow the Lord to reveal to us the motives of our heart in the way that we respond to people. Many times the reason that we're unseemly or rude is because, once again, we don't know how to suffer long. And people have wronged us and they've come against us and we respond in a rude, unseemly manner. Wouldn't it be a beautiful thing, man? I'm telling you, I can feel the freedom right now. I can feel the freedom right now. Whenever somebody treats me wrong and they're really secretly trying to elicit a response out of me. They may not even have schemed it up, but I'm telling you, some people know how to get your goat, bro. They know how to press your button, bam, and it's usually the people that are closest to you. And I'm just thinking to myself, wouldn't it be a beautiful thing if they were over there planning all that out and they tried to press that button and guess what? It didn't get the stimulation that they were looking for. In other words, the Lord has set me free. Agape showed up.
That's right.
And you know what I was able to do? Love. I was able to love. Whenever you get me going in the wrong direction, I get so mad. I'm telling you, I feel like I can break my steering wheel sometimes. I get so mad. And I would just like to be able to respond in a way of a God.
Amen. Amen.
Ha ha. No, that wouldn't be a God thing. That wouldn't be a God thing. That would be a God thing. But that the love of God would give me a different response. You understand what I'm trying to get at? I know I'm going overboard and I'm getting passionate. I feel passionate. It's about the motives of the heart. I want to love. I really do. I want to love.
Yes.
I want to love more like Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And if you're anything like me in your personality, you're the one that looks like a fool. You could be right. I'm not saying you always will be. But you could be right. And because the other person may be calm, cool, and collected, and here you are acting the fool, because you done got passionate, because that's who you are, you look like a fool, and I'm right, and everybody around us looking at us knows I'm the right one and you the wrong one, because look how you acting, your face is all red, but it don't mean you're right, just because you know how to keep your passion and your emotions down. Some people that really know me will say, quit talking to me like a psychiatrist. But what they don't understand is I'm trying to throttle down. I'm trying to like bring it down. I'm trying to make myself agape. You understand what I'm saying? All right. Now, don't behave unseemly. Don't be rude. Amen? All right. I'm being real about myself today. She doesn't seek her own. Agape doesn't seek her own. It's, in other words, agape isn't always looking to better its own situation. You hear what I'm saying? I mean, you find yourself in the midst of a circumstance and all you want is somebody to give me something. I mean, I'm not saying you. I'm saying that's what people do. Give me, give me, give me. Fix my situation. Make my situation better. Well, the idea here is that you learn to prefer your brother better than yourself.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Jesus did. He preferred his brethren better than himself. As a matter of fact, in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 9, it talks about the heart of Jesus right there. Philippians 2, verses 3 through 9, it says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, you all making requests with joy. I'm in the wrong chapter.
Yeah.
Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, So strife is you're causing chaos. Vainglory is because you're puffed up with pride and you're wanting to be seen. But in lowliness of mind, in other words, you need to be humble. Let each esteem others better than themselves. Now, you need to stop and you need to think about that for a second. We're not moving forward till you stop and you think about that. I'm not trying to control you. I'm just saying we're not moving forward till we stop and think about that. In your own life, do you really prefer other people better than yourselves? In your own life, in your own situations, are you taking advantage of people? Because if you're taking advantage of people, you need to stop and you need to let God do a work in your heart. It's not fair to take advantage of people, especially not your brothers and sisters in the Lord.
Amen.
If people are helping you, do not take advantage of that. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
It says right here, it says, look not on every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. There you go. Some people want to help people. Some people take advantage of people. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Some translations say, did not consider it something to be grasped to. In other words, Jesus was God, but he didn't say, no, I'm not going to go down there and redeem humanity. Instead, he released that, and he went and became a man. That's what it says in verse 7. But made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and he became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. So what I want you to see here is this, is that the example that we have in Jesus is that he humbled himself, he condescended, he lowered himself to make things better for others. Had he not lowered himself, you and I would still be dead in the midst of our sin. The Apostle Paul, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is encouraging the church in Philippi, let the same mind that was in Jesus be in you. Lower yourself. Humble yourself. Don't seek for yourself. Think of other people and what they're going through. I don't feel like I'm supposed to get away from this. Stop for a second, take your own shoes off, and put your feet in somebody else's shoes. Consider what they might be going through. And if you have dealings with them in any way, shape, or form, consider how your dealings are affecting them. Are you helping them or are you hurting them? And if you're hurting them, Lord, help us to help them. Amen? Does that make sense what I'm saying? Is that okay? I mean, considering that Jesus was that way, shouldn't we be that way? You know, also in the book of Acts, I'm not going to get you to turn there, but in the book of Acts, everybody's getting filled with the Holy Ghost now, right? People are being added to the church. It said that the Holy Spirit was moving on people's hearts so much that everybody started selling all of their possessions and started distributing it amongst themselves. Now, that would be beautiful if the Holy Spirit was moving on everybody's heart the same still today. But what you end up with is socialism, because some people just ride the pine. What does that mean? That means you sit the bench. That means you're not in the game. That means you go ahead and let everybody sell their property and give you some stuff while you just sit back and chill. It don't work that way. Because see, when agape shows up, because there's some other scriptures, especially when we get into 1 Thessalonians, which I'll be teaching in a series coming up, you're going to start realizing he that don't work is worse than an infidel. He that doesn't work doesn't eat. Right. So it's time to get up. I mean, listen, everybody's situation is different. Some people can't work. Some people, you know, whatever the case, they do what they can do. No, that's between them and the Lord. That's not my job to tell who's got to go to work and who doesn't go to work. What I'm trying to say is this. If a person can work, they're supposed to be doing whatever they can in order to be able to provide for themselves and in order to be able to do what is right in the eyes of God. That's the way, that's the scripture. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So you can't have the book of Acts if everybody's not being filled with the Holy Ghost. Because instead, what you got is some people that are given and some people that are taken. All right. Agape is not easily provoked. This is another one I need help with. It means to be easily stirred. I think this is where I was supposed to talk about pressing the button. That the right person presses the right button and gets you going in the wrong direction real quick. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Sometimes, you know, it'd be even better if it just wasn't fast. If I could just at least hold off for a while, you know, I'd feel better. But no, boy, sometimes it don't work that way. Yeah. It just hits you right there, man. And you know, I'm going to be honest with you, that's a lust of the flesh. That word wrath as a lust of the flesh in Galatians 5, that's what it's talking about. It's like an anger that's uncontrollable. It's not righteous anger. And the worse it gets, the more it's fed by the devil. You hear me? Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, man, it can get bad. And sometimes it can get so uncontrollable that, well, you can't control it. And you don't want to play around with that kind of anger because it can turn into a mess. And that's what it means to be exasperated, to irritate, or to provoke to a high degree. So agape isn't like that. And I just see Jesus getting beat, crown of thorns, being mocked and ridiculed. And he's not acting that way. He's responding in love. It thinks no evil. In other words, the idea behind this is that it keeps no record of wrongs. Yeah. Some of you think that I wrote the notebook because I want to talk about that love story, but that's not it at all. I was reading in a commentary, and when I was doing some of my studying, and I came across this illustration, I just thought you couldn't find a better illustration than this, so I put that there to remind myself. This one particular commentator was talking about the fact that he knew this Christian one time who carried a notebook around with him. And every time somebody did him wrong, it was like he stopped and he did a journal. So it's like November 22nd, and it's 10:55. Robert did it again. I'll pick on Robert because he can take it. He's a big old boy. Robert did it again. He knew that this was the kind of thing that got me, and so he just didn't even care, and he did it again. And then I got this notebook that I'm carrying around. Every time a Christian does me wrong, it's like I'll pencil it in. Oh, yeah, I remember that. I remember you. 1995, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I got it documented. That's what you did. You said this, you did that, you did me wrong. Keeping a note of wrongs. That's what it means to think no evil. You thought it meant something else. You thought it meant you was going to have a perfect thought life. No, it means that you don't keep record of people's wrongs. You got to let that stuff go, man. It'll produce bitterness in your heart. You got to let it go. Lord Jesus, please. Let it go. If you hold on to that, it'll kill you. Colossians chapter 3 says that. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 and 13 says, put on therefore as the elect of God. Y'all remember what the word elect means?
Special.
It means, the Greek word is elektos. And this means out. It's a preposition that means out. And this means chosen. Like election. So you're the chosen out ones. You've been chosen out by God. In other words, when you heard the gospel and you responded through faith, he pulled you out of the world into the kingdom of light. Amen. And now you're part of the body of Christ. And as part of the body of Christ, the Holy Spirit lives in you and dwells in you. And so according to what Colossians is saying in verse 12, put on therefore as the chosen out ones of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy. Well, what do you mean bowels? Your innards, your inside. Let your innards or your inside, your inner man, be full of the love of God. It's not talking about your kidneys and your spleen. Yes, that's what it means, but you got to be able to put the context together. It's talking about your inner man. Let the inside man, the new man that's been created in Christ, be filled with love and compassion. Amen. Kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another. What does that mean? Having patience. Have patience. That's easier said than done, right?
Yes.
Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. When somebody's wrong with you, forgive them. Don't hold on to it. Don't write it down in your notebook. If any man has a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. Jesus forgave us. Amen. We should forgive.
Yeah.
All right. We're going to finish up. We're going to finish this up. Verse 7. Agape bears all things, it believes all things, it hopes all things, and it endures all things. I like this first one because I was really surprised when I started digging into it. I had never seen this before. The word literally means to roof over. And the idea is that you conceal something. Specifically, it's talking about whenever people have done wrong. Now, I don't know about you, but I know for a fact, I hope it's not you, I know for a fact that there's people in the body of Christ that are just waiting and looking for somebody to fall flat on their face. Mm-hmm. They just wait. Sit back. I hope one day I see that. And what the Word of God is saying is that's not what love looks like. As a matter of fact, what love will do is it'll roof it over. It'll hide it. Conceal it for a bigger purpose. That hopefully the situation will be mended through love and grace of the Holy Spirit. See, when you're in the right gospel, that doesn't mean you're perfect. But the reality of it is that when you understand that the old man must die in Adam and that grace, hallelujah, will strengthen and change the inside of the heart, then you begin to realize.
Or else you like, change, you know?
That's right. It's a good point. Susie said that some people say they'll never change. And that's a sad thing, but people think that.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
You know, and you know, the fact of the matter is, though, is that, and they're looking to think that. Because either they have a self-righteous spirit, number one, or they just don't believe in God, period. But anyway, true love is not looking to expose everybody's faults and everybody's business. Amen.
Amen.
True love wants to see people walk in victory. Hallelujah. Believes all things means to trust. That's what the word really means. It's in the Greek, it's pistio, and it means to trust. So even though you may have done me wrong once, twice, I'm supposed to allow the agape to help me to trust you. But there's always a balance to everything. Because the fact of the matter is that there's scripture also that'll say, well, for instance, y'all read, I got a little transition for you. Proverbs 25:19. Confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint.
Mm. Yes.
You ever had a broken tooth?
Mm-hmm.
It don't feel good.
No.
It's painful. A broken tooth hurts. And a foot out of joint? What is that all about? Well, could you imagine walking down the road like this? I mean, if your foot's out of joint, you can't walk right. It means you're lame. It's not functioning properly. You can't get where you got to get going. And when you trust in an unfaithful man in such a time as this, it's like painful and it doesn't work. So there's always balance. The agape of God wants to help us to learn how to trust. Amen. To say, you know what? I'm going to believe a little bit better, and I'm going to believe that God can do a work in that person's life. At the same time, dude, you put me in, you know, a major bind financially, or sister friend, you really jacked me up over here. So guess what? I'm going to trust that God's going to do a work in your life. Don't come ask me for no more money because you're making me feel weird, dude. And whenever you pay the last bit, is it okay to expect people to pay their debt back whenever you never let them borrow it to begin with? And the reality of it is, I mean, I'm sorry, you let them borrow it, you didn't give it to them. That's why part of me don't even want to let nobody borrow nothing no more. I'm either going to give it to you, or if I really know you, there's a couple of people I'll let borrow money. They pay me back. I mean, just in a bind, dude. I just need a little bit for a little bit of time. Okay, cool. Boom, there you go. But it's like, so what you trying to say? I literally, somebody was in a bind one time. I'm just going to tell you a story. Maybe they will watch the video, and that's okay. Somebody was in a bind one time, and they needed to get a place to live. So I lent them the money. I told them ahead of time. I said, look, this is the deal. I'm going to let you borrow the money for the deposit to get the place. It's a loan. Are you okay with that? You want this place, right? You want the place, and you're in a bind, and I'm going to let you pay me back however you want. I just want you to pay me back. $50 a week, $50, whatever's good, just pay me back. Okay, cool. Bam, fist bump. Let's do this. All right, let you borrow the money. Break the lease. Don't tell nobody you broke the lease. Don't have the money to come back. 2 years later, it's like, okay, so what's the deal? Oh, yeah, well, the Word of God says that whenever you give somebody, hold on a second, Hoss, ain't nobody gave nobody nothing. We had a real clear-cut conversation on what the deal was, but the fact of the matter is that now you want to do twisted scripture with me, and you want to try to act holier than thou and try to bring me down a notch and act like I should have never let you to borrow it to begin with, and I'm just, no. The fact is that nobody likes to be held accountable.
That's right.
Yes. And you shouldn't have allowed me to let you loan the money if you had no intention on paying it back.
Right.
And I'm sorry if that makes you feel a little bit strange, but the Lord wants us handling all our business on the up and up. Amen?
Yes.
And the fact of the matter is that if you borrow money from somebody, you ought to pay it back. And if you owe somebody money, you ought to be scratching and shaking and shucking and jiving trying to get them people their money back.
Right.
Instead of doing whatever it is that you want to do on the side with your money when you got it in your pocket.
Right.
Hello? You owe somebody money. Should it all be like an alarm? Flashing. Now, you know, some people, dude, I ain't even worried no more. Look, there's a lot of things that happen in people's lives. Dude, I forgive all them debts. Anybody, all them debts are forgiven. But what I'm trying to say is this. If you actively owe somebody something, and the Lord's been dealing, that's how it ought to be. It ought to be like an alarm flashing in your heart and in your mind. Things aren't right.
Yes.
I owe somebody money. Things aren't right. I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Last thing is this. Agape endures all things. This is the same word that we talk about in Romans 5 a lot, hupomone. And it means, hupo means under, and mone means remain. It's talking about a trial. And sometimes you find yourself in the trials of life. Sometimes you find yourself in circumstances and situations that are uncomfortable, and you don't like them. You know what I'm saying? And what you want to do is you want to tuck and run. But the Lord doesn't want you to run. You can't run from every situation that you've ever been in and think that anything's ever going to change. God wants us to stand. Amen. Like a tree planted by the water, I shall not be moved. Hallelujah. He wants you to stand in Christ and to learn how to endure the trial. And when you learn how to endure the trial, amen, you learn some things in the midst of it all. You learn how to access grace, and God will begin to cause a change on the inside of you. You know, sometimes in the trial, whenever the pressure's heated, you know, we always used to talk about the proverb that I know, remember whenever we first started studying the Bible together, a couple of us in here a long time ago, we'd get back to that proverb, and it talked about the refiner's fire. And how it would cause the dross,
yes,
which was the impurities inside of the metal. And when you heat up the fire enough, what happens is that it causes the impurities to start rising to the top. And so what will happen is that the refiner will see them, and he removes them. He removes those impurities. And the longer that process takes place, they say that before long he can begin to see his reflection inside of the metal. And there's actually a proverb that also speaks of the fact that that when you remove the dross from the metal, there comes forth a vessel for the finer. Now, that's King James language, and what you would think is that, oh, okay, a finer vessel. Well, that is true. If you remove the impurities, then the vessel is finer. But it's really, the word finer really means refiner. And what it's saying is that when you remove the dross from the vessel, you end up with a vessel that's worthy for the use of the refiner. And that's what God's basically doing in our lives. And he allows trials and tribulations in our lives to produce that. We find ourselves in the midst of circumstances that are uncomfortable. And typically what we've always wanted to do, Lord, like I can tell you what I always did, whenever I find myself in uncomfortable situations,
right,
before Jesus,
right,
my mode of action was to take something.
Yeah.
Take something to just numb it a little bit. Take the edge off. I didn't know that's what I was doing, but that's what I was doing. A quart. We didn't call them 40s back then. Call them a quart. Get me a quart and, you know, another little something, and, you know, do this. And next thing you know, I'm numb. I forgot about it for at least 3 hours.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it's a repetitive type of behavior, and you don't realize it, but basically you're numbing the pain. You find yourself in the midst of untoward circumstances, so you try to numb the pain. And then the thing of it is, I got to be honest with you, I come to Jesus, and I don't really understand the gospel, and I do okay in my willpower for a while, but then the next thing you know, whenever the right kind of circumstance arises, I find myself when nobody's looking, taking a little nip off of something, just a little piece, just kind of, you know, take it down a notch, might be able to deal with it for a couple hours. But then what the Lord started showing me is that, what are you doing? You're handling your business all wrong. You're still acting like the old man. And you're still going after that very thing that was killing you. And so now you got to come after me. Amen? And so whenever we come after the Lord, he's trying to teach us in the midst of the trial how to remain under. So when you're in the trial, there's going to be some dross, some impurities that are going to be revealed to you. And the Lord wants to remove it. Amen? And when you see it, you go to him and you're like, okay, Lord, deal with this. Do something with this. And now I'm learning how to walk in Christ. Amen? Does that make sense? Amen.